The future is bright indeed. We're all of us dreaming of the better days ahead, and a part of your bright new future could be a move to where the magic lives in the greater Orlando area of Florida. One of the biggest decisions you'll make when considering a move is selecting a realtor who can successfully match you with the right home in the right location at the right price. Victor Naraki is the realtor who can help you make the move you've always wanted to. Whether you're a first-time homeowner or looking to move near Disney World, Victor is in your corner. If you are looking for an experienced real estate agent covering all of Central Florida, please visit DisneyAtYourDoorstep.com today and find out just why you should work with Victor. I encourage you to create a free, no-obligation account on his website. By doing so, you'll unlock the website's full potential and be able to enter specific criteria, save listings, and browse new properties sent to your email. Visit DisneyAtYourDoorstep.com today or visit his Facebook page, Victor Naraki Realtor. And don't forget to tell him the Grand Circle Tour podcast sent you.
The Disneyland Limited, now leaving for a Grand Circle Tour of the Magic Kingdom. All passengers board.
Star Tours announces the boarding of the Endor Express. All passengers, please prepare for immediate boarding.
Please stand clear of the doors. Por favor, manténganse alejado de las puertas.
To those guests who've just joined us, welcome. For those of you standing, please hold on to the handrails throughout our journey and stay clear of the doors.
Please keep your hands, arms, and legs inside the train and remain seated at all times. Now, hang on to them hats and glasses, because this here's the wildest ride.
I am Sam the American Eagle, and I am proud to introduce the Grand Circle Tour Podcast, a celebration of Disney parks, but mostly the American ones. I really like these guys.
Hey gang, welcome to another exciting adventure of the Grand Circle Tour Podcast. I am your host today, Captain Stan Solo, and I'm joined today with my three favorite co-hosts. I'm going to start off ladies first. Who just happened to be joining us for some reason. Ringmaster
Harley. She wasn't into the studio, and now she's here, you know.
Ringmaster Harley, welcome aboard and waltz up.
Well, yes, I wasn't invited. I just saw the topic and decided to join.
You are always invited, and that is always correct.
She just didn't leave from the last one, I don't think. That's
yeah, been here a week.
Sitting here waiting.
So tomorrow, which I think that's like 3 a.m. or something ridiculous, is my 60-day window for dining for our friend's trip to Disney World for November. And I know that doesn't matter that much anymore because dining is a lot easier to get these days, but I still like to log in and see what fun things I can get. Even though it's, you know, I can probably end up getting whatever we wanted, and I don't even know what we want yet, so I have to do a little bit more research.
Up until 3 a.m. in the morning
to figure it out. Yeah.
What I'm going to.
Well, have you tried the Toy Story restaurant yet?
So okay, well, we can go into that later, but I haven't. I was excited for it. We were going to do it last friends trip in last November. But then I saw terrible things about it on social media, how bad the food was and all the things. So we decided not to. And I don't know if we should add
See, I'm hearing good things now, though.
Yeah, I don't know. It seems
fun. I know a
few fun.
People that went and said that they really enjoyed it. And they said, don't listen to the social media people.
But in the midst of all this,
social media people
I lit
anyway.
A small candle. And I have Dollywood on the mind. So right before I logged in here, I was trying to change our flights to Tennessee instead of Disney World. And in fact, they're still texting me right now, like, oh, are we doing Dollywood now or what? So
we'll find out in 60 days where it's going
on. Exactly. Where are we?
Here we go. Also joining us today, Mission Commander Justin. Welcome and waltz up with you.
Waltz up with me. So I've been very busy, but most recently, I attended my niece's wedding in Valley City, North Dakota, and afterwards I went to Fargo, North Dakota, to hang out with my two sisters from Washington and my brother and his wife. And while we were there, Monica wanted to go to the mall. She wanted to get some Clinique makeup that she can't get here. And I'm like, okay, whatever. And then we saw a Hallmark store.
Oh.
And I was like, wait, didn't they have like some sort of like, I don't know, some haunted mansion thing? So long story short, $400 and some later, I have the whole Haunted Mansion set.
Nice.
But the hub, I've got like everything. There's one thing that I think doesn't come up until October 1st, which is like the busts, the singing busts themselves. But mm-hmm. I've got everything else. They're lit up behind me. Gaze upon them, listeners.
Very nice, very nice. I was in North Dakota yesterday, actually. For 20 minutes. I went and picked up a parcel and left. Pembina picked up a parcel.
Was it a Disney-related parcel?
Kinda. Yeah. Mm. Yeah, yes, it is. It is a Disney-related parcel. Spent $30 on fuel.
That's speak for us. Like, I've got like some sort of Disney thing I'm building, but this was just
that's
like
exactly it. The Disney thing I'm building and I needed parts.
Isn't it?
Yes, it is. You're exactly right. I needed parts. That's the Disney thing I'm building. So yeah, I'll be posting that.
All right.
Commander Dan, how are you today, my friend? And Walt's up.
Hello, Stan Solo. How are you today? My Walt's up. You know, I don't sell a lot of things on eBay. Lately, I used to a while ago, but every once in a while I'll throw a bunch of stuff up. Usually, like before the holidays, I'll put a lot of stuff on because I feel like a lot of people are buying stuff on eBay. Anyway, last October, I put on a Dumbo fig pin. You guys know what the fig pin is? Those big pins that people,
the big ones.
And no one ever bought it, and that was the last I heard of it. I guess it was still on eBay. And this morning, I wake up to a $63 bid on a $20 pin that I bought.
Nice.
After a year of just sitting there on eBay. So, Justin, I'll give you a $63 towards that. I don't know. There's someone that really, really loves.
I bought a lot of other stuff this weekend.
Someone that really loves Dumbo out there that, like, I don't know, thought that a $63 bid would be like what to do for this $20 pin.
It wasn't me.
But doesn't eBay work like proxy bidding? Like, they would only get it for whatever you set it at, no?
I don't know. I don't even know why it's still there. Shouldn't it? Doesn't it, like, end?
No, it renews. If you have it set up to auto-renew after the...
But at least I would get, like, I've done that, and I get, like, a little, like, email alert or pop-up alert that says, you have auto-renewed. That's happened for a year without me knowing about it. I have to even look to find out.
You really cannot troubleshoot your eBay.
I have to make sure I still had the pin. I was like, what is this? So I have to like find the pin.
I was going to say, you got to find it first.
Yeah, no, I found it. I found it this morning.
Down if you had eBay looking for one so he doesn't get a bad rating. What's up with me? Solo show. I got some fun stuff happening over there. I'm doing a 4-week tournament of champions. It's gonna be spread out over 8 weeks because we're only every other week podcast. So I have different contestants on each week. There's three different contestants, and the winner from each week will be competing in the tournament of champions. And it's a Disney attractions trivia question contest. So we've already recorded rounds 1, 2, and 3. We haven't aired any of them yet. I'll be recording the actual final. And I actually have a trophy this time that I'm handing out to the winner. I'm going to have to mail it out to him. Kind of hope a Canadian wins. But I'll show it to the Solo Cup.
That is so funny.
Listeners, gaze upon this.
So it's a red Solo Cup trophy for the Solo Show.
Solo Cup. Solo, I love it.
Yeah, so that's going to be going out to our winners. Let's hear from MEI, and then we'll come back with today's topic. We ruined the Disney parks, but you guys helped.
Hey there, it's Ken the voiceover guy, and I'm here with Lori Oliveri from MEI Mouse Fan Travel. Lori, when's the best time for me to book my vacation?
Always!
But really, should I wait for specials?
The best time to book your vacation is when you're thinking about it. Most of the time, the deposits are refundable up to a certain date ahead of the trip. When a promotion comes along, we will apply it to your trip to help you save money. It is much easier to look for promotions for existing trips than to hope one comes out.
If you would like more information on booking your dream vacation, visit their website at meitravel.com. And don't forget to tell them the Grand Circle Tour Podcast sent you.
All right, we're back. So I thought about this topic quite a while ago, and I was thinking about kind of all the ways that social media and vlogs and YouTubers and influencers and used to be those chat boards would give tips and tricks to kind of beat Disney. And Disney had to change because of that. So we would do things, and we would tell other people these things, and they tell other people, and Disney would go, well, we never even thought about that when we came up with this, you know, this idea, and now everybody's cheating us, you know, using this trick. So we have to change it. So basically, I'm saying that the influencers, the vloggers, and all that, they're ruining Disney, and Disney has to change, and then we get mad at Disney for changing stuff. So
was there something in particular that happened that you remember that brought this topic up?
Yeah, so the one that brought this up was, I'm not sure, Holly, if you're familiar with this or not, but I'm pretty sure Dan is and Justin, but it used to be on Tom Sawyer Island, the cast members would hide these paintbrushes. And whoever was the first person to find these paintbrushes, they would bring it to a cast member, there'd be a note on it, and they would bring it to a cast member, and they'd go, hey, I found this paintbrush, and it says on here, if I turn it in, I get a free fast pass. And the cast member would give them a fast pass for any attraction in Magic Kingdom to use that day. Well, all these people started posting these pictures of these paintbrushes on different boards and community things and stuff like that. And people started racing to Tom Sawyer Island to get these paintbrushes, but they didn't want to turn them in to get the fast passes. They wanted to put them in their backpacks and take them home. And after a while, Disney was like, well, we got to stop doing this because we're losing these paintbrushes every day. This is not working out. So they put an end to it. And then we got mad. We go, Disney, what are you doing? You're putting an end to it. It wasn't Disney's fault. It was our fault for doing that. So, and I got to thinking about that. And that's what got me thinking, that's a good idea for a topic. So what stuff did we as guests and you know, you don't even have to be a member of social media to be part of this. Chances are you told somebody something and that ruined it for everyone else.
Yeah, I was just about to say that, just to make sure we don't lose all our viewers, our listeners right away. It's not only the influencers we're talking about.
No.
And by the way, we are the influencers. So like we're kind of talking about ourselves here too. Right? Like,
even the people listening are influencers though. Because they'll go to Disney World and they'll come back and they'll tell their friends, you know, their coworkers that, you know what, I had a great time. You know, I did this, I did that. Mm-hmm. I found this trick worked. I found this worked. You know, instead of buying a poncho at Disney World, I brought some from the dollar store. That type of stuff. You know what I mean? And so Disney goes, well, we gotta raise our price on ponchos because we're gonna
because we're not selling them. Yeah,
we're not selling them, so we've got to make a bigger profit margin. Alrighty, Holly, what do you have for your first one?
Okay, so one of the things, and I don't know if it's just because more people are going to the parks or what it is, but like tickets and events seem to sell out immediately, or when they sell annual passes again, they sell out. And that's, I've never heard of annual passes selling out before this, or Oogie Boogie Bash selling out, like waiting for 14 hours online to buy Oogie Boogie Bash tickets and then them selling out. So all of these event tickets and things are going crazy. Like I've never had to wait prior to a few years ago for hours and hours online. And I have to say, it's because everybody is talking about these events. And same thing with Run Disney. Did people really, like, were they really into Run Disney before this? Before, you know, obviously runners were, but like people like me, I was gonna do it. I couldn't even get a ticket to do Run Disney. I'm not a runner, I don't run. And I was influenced because everybody makes it look so fun on social media that I now wanted to run. And I couldn't even get tickets for Run Disney. And I'm grateful I didn't now because it was 105 degrees last week when they were doing this Run Disney at Disneyland. But so I have to say that it's because we talk about all these events so much and everybody shares it. And it seems like that's the place to be. So now all of these events are selling out like crazy and instantly.
Absolutely. It used to be, don't buy your tickets in advance for the Not So Scary or the Christmas, because it could rain. You can buy it the day of. It's not a big deal. You could go there the day of, walk up to the gate and buy a ticket. But like you said, the first day, there's so many influencers in the park posting all these videos about how great it is and how wonderful it is, and everybody wants to go now. Right. And you can get the special cupcake that basically tastes the same as every other cupcake that you ever bought there, but this one might have a spider on it or something, so you gotta get that one. For sure, the Run Disney was kind of the first one that happened to that I'm aware of, at least at Walt Disney World. Those were very hard for a very long time now to get on, and people were booking those earlier. And again, because of that, Disney just keeps raising the price, and people just keep coming, and they just keep raising the price, and people just keep coming. Like, I'm sure Disney's at a point now where they're like, well, like, how much are we supposed to charge for this to level it off? Like,
right, exactly.
Yeah.
$1 million.
Right.
I know. Getting like that, yeah. Yeah. Oh, I agree completely. How about you, Justin?
You know, the thing is like I went very much smaller in my thinking when the first thing I thought of when you brought up this topic is I thought about selfie sticks. You remember selfie sticks?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's like this weird thing where you like get your cell phone out a little farther so you can take this selfie, right? And they ended up having to be banned from the parks. And why? Not because there's anything wrong with the selfie sticks themselves, but because people couldn't follow the rules. They couldn't follow the rules of, like, you can't have them on, say, the roller coaster rides or some of these other rides where it gets to be dangerous. And I remember specifically a story where the cast member had to shut down whatever the Incredicoaster was called at the time.
California Screaming.
Because someone had one of these selfie sticks out on the loop-de-loop.
Okay, yeah, that's ridiculous.
Yeah.
And so they were like, you know what? After that, they were like, no, we have to like ban these things from the entire park because we cannot trust the guests to follow the rules that we have set in place. The simple rules, like, don't have this on the roller coaster.
Well, yeah, exactly. And well, the other one too that I heard that people were doing with those selfie sticks was an attraction like the Haunted Mansion. So you got the Doom Buggies, and the Doom Buggies are set up for you to enjoy the show, for you to see the show, and that's what they face, right? So when you're going in front of the ballroom, you're facing the ballroom. With a selfie stick, you just hold it up over your shoulder behind you, and you get to see, you can shoot a whole video of what's happening that's not part of the attraction that Disney doesn't want you to see. Now, guess what? I'm posting that on YouTube. So that's exactly the reasons.
But they allow the other, like the gimbal sticks, the ones that are smaller, they're shorter. So I'm just not understanding why it's only the selfie sticks that extend to like 3 feet rather than the ones that are just a foot, because you're still having it, your phone attached to it. Like the gimbals, like your phone's attached to it pretty much the whole day there. It's like a pain to undo your phone.
So the rumor that I heard was that it was because of Big Thunder Mountain that a stick was snapped off. A selfie stick as someone was taking a video.
Okay.
Because it hit like, you know, something on top of the track or whatever.
Too tall. Yeah.
Yeah.
can see a million issues that it could cause. And but especially, I also,
you know, too far out and something could happen. And especially on like on Big Thunder Mountain or anything, any of these roller coaster rides in particular, it could be a very dangerous situation. I mean, you could literally be injured, if not die.
Right.
And they're like, we don't want you to do that. And you have people who won't follow those very simple rules. So the only way to get around that then is to like ban it entirely from the park.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or even worse, you're holding it on a big Thunder Mountain, it snaps and hits the person behind you.
Right.
You know?
And those are like metal and...
Well, the, yeah, and there's a phone attached to it, which is basically a brick.
Yeah, but
I would
all bad.
It would definitely be
a metal sphere attached to a metal brick. This is not a good situation, no matter how you look at it. Especially if you're looking at it as it's hurtling towards you very quickly.
It would be my luck to die in a serious self-inflict accident on right. the mountain. I can't imagine getting that phone call from my wife, you guys. Like,
oh my gosh. He was impaled. Yeah,
your husband got selfie sticked.
I'm sorry, Dan was impaled.
Yeah, well,
and plus on Big Thunder Mountain.
Plus, other guests' frustration when you're trying to watch the fireworks or the castle show. It's bad enough you got these people holding up their phones, you got people with their kids on their shoulders, you got people holding up their iPads. Now all of a sudden you add another 60, 70 selfie sticks to the equation.
Right.
Yeah, you're going to end up having selfie sticks whacked over each of people's heads for sure.
Right.
Yeah. All righty, Dan. That was a good one, Justin, for sure. Absolutely.
I'm going to start off very controversial here. And I know this is a very sore subject for a lot of people. And I'm not saying what side of the subject I'm on, but... It's the DAS service.
Clear in time.
The DAS service, the disability changes that they've made recently.
Okay.
That was made for one reason. Too many people took advantage of it. And I know that there are people out there that need the service, and there are people out there that are upset that the service has changed and it's harder to get the access. But I know personally, like 100 people. I'm exaggerating a little, but a lot of people that use that service when I don't think they needed the service. You know, like close friends of mine. And quite frankly, I was part of that. You know, I went with some of these friends and then were able to go on because son, you know, may have had some. You know, borderline attention span issues or something like that. And now there's a party of 12 of us that all get to go on the line for free, right? Like,
right.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
I saw a lot of things before these restrictions came into place. I saw a lot of people almost like advocating for this is how you like beat the system.
Yeah. Right.
And we know, right? We're like in...
Oh my God. I mean, this is like what the... What Stan's topic here was designed to talk about, but yeah,
exactly.
That one was, oh my God, that was terrible because there were these people saying, "Here's how you beat the system. Here's how you wound the system.
This is what you say.
Pretend you have some sort of disability, and it does such a disservice to the people who actually have those disabilities." Who actually need these services. And I am going to get, I'm going to like kind of calm myself down now because I'm about to get very worked up. So let's just say I'm very upset about that.
And about and there were people doing tours, doing their own personal private tours of the parks. And they were using the DAS system to get their clients onto the attractions quicker.
Yeah.
So I was wondering about that because I was just talking about that with my friends the other day about the one guy that recently got banned because he was doing that. And we were wondering, wait, how did he get his people on the rides like a VIP tour guide would?
Yeah.
And so you just answered that. So that's...
And that's a whole nother... A whole nother topic that we could talk about because not all of those how do you say, I don't want to use the word fake, but like
unofficial
independent tour guides
right? They all got banned, and not all of them were using that. was yeah. because of that. But they then had to like take it a step further by saying you can't also make money off of Disney without our permission, right?
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah. And you know.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. For sure. That is a good one. That is a good one for sure, Dan.
Oh, yeah.
And then you said,
but oh, that's something that just totally grinds my gears, as they say. Oh, that.
Okay. But then again, we make hundreds of thousands of dollars a year off of Disney, right? On this podcast, you know,
and famous.
We're multi-millionaires because we are just
exactly
such super.
So mine is this again. This is going back to the old boards that used to happen. This is pre Magic Bands and stuff like that. When it used to, you would book your trip and you could do these add-ons. One of the add-ons you could do was PhotoPass. And one of the tricks that people would do back then was you would get different people in these chat rooms that would all chip in and split a PhotoPass account. So instead of three families paying $100 each, there'd be three families paying $33 and, you know, 39 cents, whatever, 30 each. And you would get the PhotoPass card. And you would hand it off. You would meet up in the parks and you would hand off this card. So my vacation would start on Monday. The person before me, their vacation ended on Monday. We would meet. I'd get the card. I have it for a week. And then I would hand it off to the next person. And then they would get it for a week. So we would split a PhotoPass account. I'm guilty for that. I ruined it. That was one of the people that ruined it. So I would get the PhotoPass for the entire week for $33.
But how did they change it?
They switched it now that once the Magic Bands came, you had to use your Magic Band to scan.
It's not a card you could pass off.
Instead of the card, you used to get the PhotoPass card.
QR code on your phone now.
Well, there is still people sharing PhotoPass. I'm not saying they aren't, but that used to be one of the tricks that people did. And Disney caught on to that, and they put an end to it pretty quick.
When I was planning my cruise, someone talked to me about the PhotoPass, and they were like, oh yeah, just get one photo pass and you could share it between the two rooms. I'm like, well, how's that possible? And they're like, oh, well, just make sure one person in your room is in all the pictures, you know, and then you can get a picture of your parents.
But that's what they've told us to do. Because that's what it was Disney probably me told you. Yes, because when we book our two rooms, we're the same family, but we have to have two rooms. And so I can't pay for two photo passes for our same family. So well, they have told us.
But Holly, think of it. And I understand your point. I get it. But think about like what you're paying for, right? Like that's double the amount of photos, right? There's more people to take photos that are walking around the ship. So like, you know,
but
just
not
from
for me, not
I know not for you, but like,
yeah,
technically it's only supposed to be for the one room, right? So, like, if you do it that way, the person from that one room has to be in every single picture. Otherwise, it doesn't work. So, like, my parents couldn't just take a picture by themselves without me in the background. Like, hi. You
know, like, photobombing.
So, you know, listen, it's annoying, but, like, yeah.
Than
yeah,
you my case.
Photoshop Dan out of all those.
Yeah, than your case.
But yeah, that used to be one of the things that we used to do in the chat boards. We would have, there was actual PhotoPass chat boards that you could split a PhotoPass card throughout your vacation. And that would Disney put an end to it pretty quick. And it was one of those things that, you know.
They did that too with tickets. I remember Disneyland, I never had to do this because I always had a annual pass, but there was companies that would buy like the 10-day tickets and then they would sell a day or two to somebody and then they would use 2 days of it and pay whatever, $40 a day or something. You would turn that ticket in back to the company through a Dropbox and then they would sell it to another family and they would get like five different people to use that one 10-day ticket because, you know, the longer days you buy, the cheaper it gets.
Yeah.
And so that's when they changed it several years ago to it has to be one person and they do your fingerprint and they take your photo because people were trading in these, and that there was a company, and it was right at the entrance of Disneyland, right under that hotel. It was actual like ticket sales, and they had drop boxes, and you would drop off your used ticket at the end of the night after you left. So
yeah, exactly. Oh yeah, for sure. And that's cheating the system, doing that. Right. That makes me wonder, like Disneyland Paris, when I went, there was no fingerprint scan, there was no photo taken or anything. All you do is scan your card and go in. Like, how do they know whether I borrowed somebody's annual pass or whether I bought a ticket?
Maybe they don't have as many issues like that over there.
Yeah, I guess not. It's coming soon to Disneyland Paris. Photo ID when you go through your...
right.
Because they would have one cast member watching like 20 or 10 gates at Paris. It was, wow. It was different. Who's Holly? You're next.
Okay, so unrealistic expectations. So
that was my next one.
Oh, I can do it right here.
Unrealistic expectations.
You know, this is a topic. It's almost not conducive for the whole round the world, as it were. We should just do whatever we can come up with.
Yeah, right. We'll talk a lot about this one. So.
As Stan mentioned earlier, the influencers coming on day one of an event or Run Disney or whatever, and they make it look amazing. Many times these influencers are hosted by Disney, so they're not going to come in and say anything negative because they're not going to get hosted again. So you have them talking about this food item and this ride and the wait times are nothing. Well, that's because they probably got gifted Genie Plus or they had a VIP tour guide and they got to go on everything with no wait times, whatever the reason is. And then you have regular people watching and seeing, wow, this looks amazing. Like there's nothing bad about this food. Everything's perfect. Mm-hmm. And then they go and they spent thousands of dollars to be there and they were out of the food item that was advertised. The merchandise that they wanted that was advertised was gone. They had to wait in lines. It rained or whatever it was. And now they're mad and now they're starting fights on Main Street. So,
well, I had honestly written that down as one of my things. It was just higher expectations that the fans... The influencers and such set for everyone, and then they get there and it's like it doesn't live up to those expectations because of all of the reasons you just laid out. So
well, we've heard those stories of people that go to Food and Wine or Festival of the Arts or any of those things and they go, I'm going to eat everything around the world, I'm going to try one of thing of everything, and then they get their bill and wait a minute, how much did that cost me?
Right.
They're just tapping their magic band, you know, every stop, tapping their magic band, not realizing that every little thing costs, you know, $5 to $10 to $12.
I don't think anything's
$500 later. You know.
Right.
Yeah. Absolutely. Dan, you wrote that down. What were your thoughts on that?
For YouTube, for Instagram, for whatever, it's like they're just kind of going around. They don't share all of those prices as they're going, let's just do this. And they show the thing and they show the thing and they show the thing. And
Right. Exactly.
Yeah. I was just to think of a specific example. I'm going to go to recent events is how it's ruined D23 for me, or the Fan Expo, whatever we're calling it now. And, you know, I get it, right? Like, first, 2 years ago, we had the unrealistic expectations that there's going to be groundbreaking announcements every 2 years. Like, that's not going to happen. Like, everyone's got to understand that's not going to happen. But it did put pressure on Disney. And with the opening of Epic Universe, I get it. Disney had to make a lot of groundbreaking announcements this go around. And we sat here and we did our live show and I thought it was a lot of fun and there was a lot of surprises we never expected, like the Villains Land to be a thing, and it was, and you know, all this stuff was announced and it was like, holy cow, like this is really cool. And all I heard the next coming weeks was how crazy it is that we're getting rid of Tom Sawyer's Island and Frontierland isn't a thing anymore and Cars Land doesn't belong there and how can they do this and blah, 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 blah. And it's like, Like, what do you want? Like, what will make people happy? Is it a fifth gate? Is that it? Because guess what? That's going to happen. If we add a fifth gate, all the prices are going to triple. Like, so be careful what you wish for, right? Like, that's not the answer, is a fifth gate. So, you know, I don't know. I think we should all be very happy with all of the announcements. There was so much that was announced. And I get that, like, Disney fans are nostalgic. And, like, that could be a whole nother thing to talk about, is, like, you know, how nostalgic Disney fans are, how annoying that is, how it can be at times, right?
Yeah.
One of my favorite, you guys know, my favorite.
How much does it need to be a museum versus how much does it need to be a theme park that caters to the people of today?
Yep.
That is always going to be an issue.
You all know that Frontierland is my favorite place in the Magic Kingdom and probably Walt Disney World. I get it, though. I understand why it has to change and why things have to progress. And, you know, like, so, yeah, am I upset? Yeah, I'm upset. Was I upset when Splash Mountain went away? Yeah. But guess what? I'm over it. It's not like I'm, like, bashing Disney every time I get because of that.
Yeah. I agree with you completely, but so help them if they touch Muppets.
It is kind of a museum piece. But it almost has to be, because it is the last thing that Jim Henson worked on. And so I think that's almost a little different than some of the others.
But again, like, you're talking to another huge Muppet fan, but, like, okay, so when is the expiration date? Can't be 500 years from now with a Muppet thing.
I get that. I do get that. And it's like, You could probably make that same kind of argument for, like, Tom Sawyer Island, because but Tom Sawyer Island, how many people went over there?
How many people go in Muppets, though? Like, that is the truth.
Yeah, that is another thing as well.
Yep. Because
Muppets definitely is a bigger draw than Tom Sawyer Island.
It's an empty theater.
It's empty all the time, man.
No, it's never. That's not empty. I've seen the Tom Sawyer Island raft go with two people on it, and one of them's driver.
Yeah, and I've been in the Muppet Theater with, like, 20 people in it for a 15 minute show. It's gonna, you know, yeah. I mean, come on, we all know that's the case. Especially morning.
Muppet Theater is something, like I say, it's like, it almost feels like it needs to be a museum piece because of its.
Yeah.
Well, Stan just logged off.
Muppet history. Tom Sawyer Island doesn't necessarily have that same museum quality, but you can make the same argument that how many people are making that trip across on that barge to go over there?
Yeah. I haven't done it in years.
That was how difficult it was to get there. Yeah. It was enough of a barrier that not many people were even going over there anymore.
Yeah, it's probably been 15 years since I went.
I would say if you're questioning any attraction, like, insert attraction here, my question to you would be, rope drop it and see if it's crowded. Yeah. And you can't just say, oh, well, that doesn't count, rope drop. No, it does count, because you could put something there that can get crowds at rope drop.
That's a different point. Like, when you go, Muppets is probably open at rope drop, but when I go, Muppets doesn't open until, like, 11 o'clock. So I try to go off out. I try not to go in, you know, July, August, when it's busier.
So you're saying it doesn't even open until 11 o'clock?
Honestly, it doesn't open until, like, 11 o'clock.
Okay, so Stan, that is the problem right there.
Yeah, but it doesn't cost them anything to have it not open.
Well, yes, it does. It's costing not, like, real estate for other things that can be there.
All I gotta say,
we're having a very philosophical discussion now.
Oh no,
it's transcended.
All right, who was that? That was Holly. Justin, your turn.
I think, was it my turn? I don't think it was my turn.
Yeah, Holly did the influencers.
Isn't that what? Yeah, it's your turn, Justin. If you could skip if you like.
we were having a good discussion. Okay. My second one that I had written down was the inability of our guests / fans to, quote, hang on to them hats and glasses. Because how many times does a ride go down And that is ultimately the reason why. Someone dropped a hat. Someone dropped some glasses. They could have got on the track. And that is why they have to shut the whole thing down. So something like Rise of the Resistance, it's not only because it's a brutal ride, but it's because if someone drops something, anything, anywhere in that track, they not only have to shut it down, clear the track, but then they have to reset the whole thing. Mm-hmm. One of the reasons I was on, when I was on Space Mountain and it got shut down, I was told someone dropped a hat and I could see it because it's like one of those hats got onto the track. You don't want one of these ride cars coming down at however many miles per hour, hitting something, and then suddenly stopping.
They always remind you too when they go around to check your restraints.
Yeah.
They do. And yet there are. That's why so many of these ride stops happen, because it's like someone dropped a hat, someone dropped a.
Their phone, their glasses,
that could have been
a really good example of that is Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railroad, where you get that air blast, and people they tell you, like I always wear a hat when I go, and they tell me don't wear your hat because you're gonna lose it. So I take it off, and you're riding. You go, this is ridiculous. I'm not gonna lose my hat. You put it back on. I mean, I didn't. But I have seen you ride a stop, and then the cast member comes walking out looking for somebody's hat.
Yeah.
I was on with Chris when this happened. And
My wife is a culprit of shutting down Dudley Do Right's Ripshore Falls in Universal because of that exact same thing. Her glasses fell off, and I had to shut the whole ride down to get her glasses. I was sitting on the
war opening. Because it's like you have to shut it down because you can't risk that.
Yeah. Right. Another one too that happens is like if somebody's wearing like a long scarf or something for whatever reason, like or a purse, and let's see, Haunted Mansion, the strap hangs over a bit. They'll stop it and tell them, and you hear those announcements: pick your scarf up, pick your scarf up. And they're not realizing it's them that they're talking to.
I think that's only a Canada problem.
Well, there's no Haunted Mansion in Canada.
I did. When I wore my scarf in July at Haunted Mansion, it was...
Exactly. Oh, Dad, we all know that was August.
You don't see any Canadians wearing scarves in Disney World. Like, in January, you do see people wearing scarves. And they're not Canadians. Alrighty, Dan.
What about you?
Justin just went. Now it's your turn.
No, I went. I just did the whole D23 example. I don't have too many left.
What? Oh, wait, my turn?
I did the D23. Then Justin went right after me.
Oh.
Now it's your turn.
I'm going to have to rewind the tape because I think something's wrong here.
Dan's officially lost control of the show.
I think what happened was Justin and I flopped, and that got you.
I think you took Justin.
Yeah.
Okay, so mine is going back to the old. Dining. What was the food where you could the food plan, the dining plan,
uh-huh.
The dining plan. Okay,
the dining plan. And back in the day, the cellier was the best deal, and everybody knew it, and that was the problem. It was one dining credit, and you get one of the best steaks for one dining credit you're ever going to find at Le Cellier. So it became pretty much next to impossible to get a dining reservation on a cellier.
Right.
And everybody wanted it. That was like the number one thing you're going to book when your dining plan came up. Holly's talking about she having to book her dining. It was next to impossible to get a cellier, especially, So Disney changed it. They said, well, everyone's complaining they can't get a cellier reservation. Let's make it 2 credits.
Yeah.
And that started the whole 2-credit trend. And then it kind of opened the floodgates where all these restaurants that are hard to get, Disney just went, well, no problem. We'll make it 2 credits. And that was just word of mouth. People saying that's the best deal when your food plan, your dining plan is to get Le Cellier. And that's what started the whole 2-credit deal with dining.
Can I add another thing to this?
Mm-hmm.
Something that I learned recently, they stopped the conversion. You used to be able, you get a certain amount of quick services and sit downs and snacks. And what tended to happen was people would not use all their quick services. And at the end, they could then convert their quick services into snack credits. I forget what it was. I don't know if it was a 1-for-1 ratio or whatever.
I think it was 2-for-1. You can get 2 snack credits.
I think you're right. So, and then what happened? People just get the gummy bears and pack their bags with all this stuff.
Krispy Squares, the last deal at the resorts. Yeah.
So they just stopped the conversion.
Really?
Yep. So
I didn't know that.
Who was it? What's her name?
T-Nina.
Yeah. She actually posted this and I commented on it. And so she, now
that's
she either
bummer.
Has to. It is a bummer. But Disney's, I guess, looking at it we know what you're going to do. You're just going to get free snacks. But I don't know. I'm not necessarily against that either. I think that's what's wrong with doing that, right?
Right. I was just going to say, what's wrong with instead of getting a meal, you're like, I want a sweet treat.
Yeah.
And it's equivalent to 2 because you're not getting a meal. So I don't. Yeah. I'm not.
All those Rice Krispie treats are going to expire now.
Because exactly.
I'll be taking 2 of them home instead of a snack meal.
Yeah.
One time I was sitting at Port Orleans Riverside and waiting for the bus to pick us up early in the morning. And there was a guy there beside me and he had a backpack. It was just filled with Rice Krispie treats and gummy bears and cookies and stuff. And I said, wow, you're bringing a lot of souvenirs home. He says, well, we had the deluxe dining plan where we get 3 table service meals a day. And there was 6 in his family and we can't eat that much.
Oh, yeah.
So they were allowed 4 snack credits per table service credit they had left over. So he had a ton of snack credits left over. Plus, they had all their snack credits they didn't use because they were going to get 3 snacks a day plus 3 table service back then. So
holy
he says, I still got 20 credits left, snack credits left. I go, well, why don't you go get it? He goes, I don't have any room in my suitcase. Do you want them? I said, sure. He goes, let's go before the bus gets here. So we went and I grabbed a whole bunch of Rice Krispie treats.
That's funny.
Stuff. Yeah. My wife is ecstatic. I got back with all these cookies and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've done that. I've gifted a family a lunch because I had so many... table service or counter service. It's just use them.
Wow. That's crazy.
Yeah. That's. But they Disney tracks those things. They know how many snack credits people have left over. They know how many people are complaining. I can't get reservations. You got to do something. Well, we'll do something. We'll double the price. All righty, Holly.
Okay. What about social media teaching us how to break the rules? So
this could be a whole show in and of itself. I'm just going to say.
I just have 2 examples here. And Stan has recently talked about the one, but I just saw a video about hiding. They hid an adult in a stroller in the theme parks. And they went to several theme parks. I think they went to an airport. So some of this is actually disturbing. How they got in places. But I've seen that was a rare one and that one was supposed to be funny. But with kids that are in, believe me, I think 3-year-old is crazy that you have to pay the same price as an adult as a 3-year-old. There should be a tiered price, but I'm not going to get into that. But there's 8 and 10-year-olds where they're showing you how to sneak them in with the stroller by doing different things. And once again, that's ultimately hurting the rest of us. And then the situation where the girl wore a very inappropriate shirt, or did she just wear a bra? I don't know. And Disney at the gate told her, you can't come in like that. Here's a voucher to go get a Spirit jersey. There wasn't a limit actually on the voucher. So she went and got a Spirit jersey, which was the most expensive shirt she could purchase. Well, everybody else started doing that as well, wearing inappropriate shirts with language of course. So then they had to stop doing that because they couldn't afford, I have to say that leniently, couldn't afford, but they couldn't do that for everybody that wanted to come in wearing an inappropriate shirt. So I know those are just two examples. Or at the very least,
they didn't want to encourage people to wear inappropriate shirts just yes. to get a shirt.
But so I don't know if they completely stopped the rule, because now the clothing that I'm seeing people wear into the parks is all inappropriate. And I don't know if that's just how they dress or they're trying to get free shirts. But some things I'm like, what are you wearing? But anyways, so I'm sure there are other instances where they're trying to teach people how to break the rules. And these are just like tips and tricks.
Here's the sad part. There was one time someone with inappropriate clothing, like just, you know, no shirt on or whatever, walking into guest services, probably saying, hey, you're going to give me something free? And they looked at him and they're like, no, we're not going to do that now. You know?
Right. Yeah. I know.
You can leave. Yeah. Come back. Well,
they have to, because not every cast member allowing people, you know, checking their tickets is going to actually look at every single person's attire to make sure that it's appropriate. Right. Mm-hmm. So there were probably numerous people that went to City Hall to say, hey, aren't I indecent? Aren't I?
How indecent do I need to be?
Yeah, exactly.
So. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no, for sure. I remember there was somebody was bragging about how they glued shoes underneath their kids' shoes, like soles, to make their kid taller so they can get on the roller coasters.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, I'd rather risk the death of my child than to not go.
There was a celebrity talking about, oh my gosh, who was it? And they were a Disney star, and they talked about how they went and bought 2 Snickers bars and shoved them in their kids' shoes so they could ride whatever ride, and they got in big trouble, especially because they were a Disney movie celebrity, and I cannot remember who that was.
Waste of 2 Snicker bars.
Well, that's what I was thinking. Gosh, how much did those Snickers cost at Disney? But
Snickers really satisfies.
And I'm sure there was chocolate all over their toes at the end.
Yeah, no kidding. Yeah,
but they got to ride the ride.
Oh, my gosh. How about you, Justin? Do you have another one?
I have more if you want, if you don't have anything.
I have one more.
I'm almost afraid that you have more.
go ahead.
I was going to say, it's like just kind of general bad attitudes. And this isn't specific to Disney fans, but I've seen it kind of everywhere since the pandemic. But a lot of people just seem to have a bad attitude toward any sort of service workers everywhere. And it's present in Disney as well, where people are just being
entitled
the bleeps to cast members. And that causes the cast members to not be as good to other people.
So true.
Because they get hit with so much abuse throughout the day. I mean, it's got to be hard to keep up that sort of positive attitude to everyone when there's a certain percentage of people who are just being bleeps.
Yeah. Well, and it goes back to the unrealistic expectations.
Yeah.
That they're getting disappointed over things and taking it out on cast members because maybe they did try to ask for something that they were told on social media they could get, and they don't do that or whatever, and then they're upset.
Yeah. So it's like, I mean, it's just something, it's like, and that's just like guests, not necessarily fans specifically, but I know that's happening a lot, and it just really bothers me.
Yeah, I get that. Even like I work in a grocery store, and inflation's going through the roof. It's not just in the U.S. It's right around the world, including
Canada. It is around the world. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And people seem to think because they're paying more is almost like what my feeling is, that they're entitled for more.
Right.
Like I'm not making more than I did
for milk. Well, I get to be mean to you.
Exactly.
The person's telling me the milk.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm paying $150 a day to go to Disney World. I get to be, you know, I'm entitled to have a good time. I'm entitled to have this, you know, I'm entitled to skip the line at the grocery store. I mean, you know, people, that's not the reality. And the people working in the stores, the people working at...
I spent to get here.
Yeah.
It's not a reason to be a jerk.
Well, that's right. Just it. Like, and the cast members aren't making any more than they were a year ago. I'm not making any more than I did a year ago. Nobody is that's working in these retail industries. So you got to lighten up, people.
Yeah.
Only on podcasts are you making more.
Only in podcasts.
I know. Dan, do you have something to tell us?
Well, he is the accountant of the group. So yeah,
I saw her. I'm
more than Dan's been letting
it's on. The easiest accounting job I've ever had in my life. Zero plus zero equals... zero, I think.
I did see the T Public check come in this month.
Oh, I did see that. We made a dollar on T Public or something.
I made a dollar 43. Already done.
These people are ruining Disney for me. The people that say Walt wouldn't approve of this, or Walt would be rolling in his grave. God. Or Walt would
heads in one and his body.
Yeah, right.
Oh my gosh, I knew that you were gonna say that.
Yeah, I mean, I hate this argument, and by the way, I've used it. I know you've all used it. Like we've all said it, right? But like, first of all, no one has ever met Walt Disney that say these things.
Right.
And Walt's quotes that you see out there are all about progress and change, and you don't know what his feelings would be. In today's day and age, you don't know what his opinions on inflation would be.
Person from the
few exactly, exactly,
or even the few TV appearances that he made.
Exactly, and like even the family members that like represent the Disney family now, you don't know Walt would agree with what some of these family members are saying. I don't agree with what my family members say, right? Like,
well, the family members don't even agree with what Walt would say.
I know, 100%.
One is saying Walt would absolutely say no to that. The other one is saying Walt would love this. Like,
yep.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, listen, we all love Walt, and we all have a special place in our heart for Walt, but...
Iconoclast, you're mapping a lot of what you want to believe onto someone that you want to agree with you.
Yeah, because we have, like, we hold Walt as this figure that we all love and adore, you know, so we want to use him as, like, almost like a god of Disney, right?
Right.
Yeah, yeah, no, absolutely, for sure, for sure. That is a good one. Do we have time for one more round, or Holly, you got one, I got one?
Well, you're in charge, so you tell us.
Okay, alrighty. I got a couple more here. One's really quick. I'll do two of them. I don't know if this one's real or not, but I did see a video where this happened, and then it never happened again. When somebody yells out, "Andy's here!" in front of Woody and Buzz, and they fall to the ground, yep. And that Disney put an end to that pretty quick because. Everybody was yelling. The rumor is that everybody was yelling, "Andy's here," and the cast members got tired of falling to the ground. But then the other thing was that the cast members could get hurt, and that's why they put an end to it right away. I don't know which one's true, which one's not. But again, that was another thing that happened on social media.
That's on my list too as well, but that's for that new random rodeo. So they do that in the restaurant, and because it was all over, it was supposed to be like a secret thing and a one-off and only happen every once in a while. And then you have it kind of ran its course. And I don't know if they're doing it anymore because it got to be too much where every single person coming in to dine was doing that. And you can't freeze every couple seconds, right? Like every couple minutes.
I think cast members do it now.
It's okay. Fun if it happens in isolation, but if it happens so frequently that it's a thing, that it's
right.
You kind of almost have to stop it just because.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
It's not that much fun. I was going to say the whole Muppet Labs photo op this year with at Epcot, where it got shut down because people were like ripping the whole thing apart when there wasn't someone there standing guard.
That's terrible.
I didn't even hear about this.
Oh. No, this was something at the Epcot Food and Wine Festival, like right now, there was like a whole Muppet Labs setup where you could do photos. But when there was when there wasn't a cast member there, people started like tearing it apart and they took it away. And they're they're supposed to be bringing it back again because they fixed it up. But again, it's one of these things. It's like people are like going, oh, well, we love the Muppets, so we're going to rip pieces of this for ourselves.
Yeah, I'm taking Beaker's nose. Idiots. Idiots, the whole lot of them. But that's not mine. That's not the one I have. The one I have is off-season. There used to be a couple of times a year was what they considered off-season, where it was way cheaper to go. It was way less crowded to go. It was often cooler at that time to go. There was less children running around. It was a dream world. Off-season doesn't happen anymore. There really isn't an off-season anymore because everybody talked about go on off-season, and now it's kind of ruined it because there is no longer an off-season.
I had somebody recently ask me about that, and I'm like, there's no off-season anymore. There's no dead time anymore. Like, we used to have on the charts, it would say ghost town days, and you would go to Disneyland on a Tuesday, and there would be nobody there.
Part of that is because Disney caught on to it and started doing basically surge pricing. Where they would charge more for the busy times and charge less for the dead times, and because they wanted to even it all out, and they accomplished that. But we don't like it.
Well, and I think to kind of stem off of that, I can guarantee you the next big hurricane that comes through Florida, the parks are going to be packed. Because everyone is going to flock. Everyone's going to book a flight. Everyone's going to drive. Let's all go to Disney World because no one is there during the hurricane. Uh-huh. And you just watch. It hasn't happened yet, but it's going to happen. Where the parks are going to be insane with people going.
The only thing I will say about this is that this week, there's been numerous reports on how empty Magic Kingdom is. Mm-hmm. And I just quickly pulled up the touring plan crowd calendar. Hollywood Studios was rated a 1 out of 10.
Wow.
The last time that was done was like before the pandemic. Wow. That was on September 11th.
So the reasons for why Disney is quiet right now, it probably needs to be a separate episode. But I will say, I was just looking at it earlier today, and they had sales. For the week before Christmas, like the between Thanksgiving and Christmas, they were running sales on the resorts.
There's a reason behind this, Justin, and the reason is Universal went through the same thing. They're going through the same thing. As soon as you make these huge announcements that things are coming, no one's going to go until those things come, and that is why Disney has to be very careful with these huge events.
But
I couldn't even get a reservation today.
I was just kind of shocked by that because I'm that's the busiest time of the year.
Yeah, and they're going. My prediction: if we do another prediction show, they're going to have one of the lowest revenue years next year, and they have to know that. They know that going in.
Or it could be that the people will go, well, there is no off season, so I might as well go with it when I can go when the kids are out of school anyways. You know what I mean? It's like a pendulum.
You're right. It is a pendulum. You know, it goes back and forth.
And the pendulum is now at the point where there is an off season.
Yeah.
And everyone's going to go next year. Everyone's going to go this week because it's so quiet. It's not going to be an off season again.
Yeah. It's always going to be busy days. You know, it's always going to, but.
Yeah, so going back to like teaching people how to get things. So I can't think of anything off the top of my head, but how they teach you for little freebie things or things that they've got pixie dusted. And then people start expecting these freebies, cupcakes, treats, things like that were just randomly pixie dusted because people talk about it. One example, and Stan was with me for this, was there's a secret room. It's called the office at Laplight Lounge in DCA. And you can't make a reservation for this special room. And I don't know how you get it except for getting it pixie dusted or asking for it. So when Stan was there and we had reservations, I went to the cast member when we were about to be seated and asked, can we be seated in the office? And the office is not even supposed to be known. You're not even supposed to know that this room exists, right? And the particular cast member that I asked was very upset with me that I even asked, knew about this room, asked
really?
To be seated there, and wow. She was really, really, really rude, actually, and said, that is not something you ask for. That is pixie dusted when we can, and basically when we want to do it, when it's available to be pixie dusted. That's not something you request. I didn't know. I had no idea. I see people eating there all the time. It looked cool. You have to do a secret password and like code, like turn these knobs and so many times and to get in this room. And I thought it would be cool because we were there with a big group. But I had no idea, but I could understand that she would be annoyed because she probably has a lot of people asking for that. And it isn't supposed to be something that's known. It's supposed to be a secret and just randomly given to people. So,
and I think you even told the cast member that you're with several people that aren't Disneyland people, that right. This is their first time here.
I also feel like she was just honestly being a jerk because yeah. The cast member next to her said, because she's like, and it's already reserved. Like, somebody's already in there. And the cast member next to her said, no, they just left. And she's like, I already told her it's not available. So so had I asked him, we maybe would have gotten it. But I do see that it could be an annoyance when you have something that is yeah. supposed to be special and just randomly pixie dusted. And you start having people asking for it when it's supposed to be a surprise. So I do see the frustration, but I didn't know. I had no idea. I didn't know it wasn't something we would ask for.
Yeah. So. Yeah. I mean, yeah, that's the thing. Like, I've been pixie dusted free popcorn from time to time and stuff like yeah. that. And it's great when it happens. But then people do want to take advantage of it. And you know what right. I mean? And they'll say, like they'll go, a cast member will say, that's a really nice shirt. Well, do I get free popcorn because I got such a nice shirt? Like, no, that's not how it works. And I've heard people say that.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
that's annoying.
But I want to thank you three for joining. This was an awful lot of fun. I think this was a fun topic. People listening, if you made it this far, let us know. what type of things did we do and you, and we're including you and everyone that ruined Disney? I'd like to know.
Let us know how you personally ruined Disney. We want to know.
I think we should do another topic, spin it. Like, how did we help Disney? How did we improve things
yeah.
by Blink Blabbermouse?
Yeah, yeah. There is an awful lot, for sure. Yeah, that influencers and ordinary people by saying, hey, you got to go. This is great. I mean, honestly, I probably would have ever gone to Walt Disney World if it wasn't for certain YouTubers and podcasters
right.
talking about it. Like, yeah, I was interested. That's why I started listening to podcasts to go to Disney World. Like, I didn't go till I was an adult. My daughter was 15 our first time we went. And the thing that kind of kicked me in the rear end to get going was certain podcasters talking about it and saying how right. magical it was and how great it was. So absolutely, that's a great point, Holly, for sure. And with that, Ken, take it.
If you would like to keep the adventure going after the show, be sure to like our Facebook friends page, Grand Circle Tour Magical Ticket Holders. While you're on Facebook, like our group page, Grand Circle Tours. Be sure to follow us on Twitter, Grand Circle Tour Podcast, as well as Instagram, GCT Podcast, and our YouTube channel, Grand Circle Tour, and on TikTok at Grand Circle Tour Podcast. That's all one word. If you would like to email us, drop us a line at gctpodcast@gmail.com. T-shirts and other fun merchandise can be found at tpublic.com. Simply search Grand Circle Tour Podcast. If you enjoyed your adventure, leave us a review on Apple Podcast. Only one rule, make it good. All logos, sounds, songs, and music that are made by and for Disney and its affiliates are owned in full by the Disney Corporation and are not, nor are they intended to be owned in any way by the Grand Circle Tour Podcast. Thank you for riding with us, and welcome home.
Please exit to your left by stepping away from the cars with your left foot first. Step out and stand on the moving platform, please.
Please exit by stepping away from the cars with your left foot first. Step out and stand on the moving platform, please.